Hello, members. It's LA. It is October 26th. We had quite an interesting week again last week with, the idea that we were going to have a range trade, but we never saw the top of the range. Instead, we saw this market do what this market loves to do, and that is it just barged ahead, one of those V-shaped reversals, so to speak, where anything to the downside was a no-no, and instead it was, this kind of action. So, we're about here on the V. We'll look at that on the charts. The question is will we see new highs again, or is this some sort of a distribution pattern? And we'll talk about that as we go forward. But anyway, big week up, just tremendous large gains. You usually don't see this on a weekly basis on the upside. You can get that kind of action on the downside, but usually not on the upside. But then again, this is not your usual market. It hasn't been for a while. Let's kind of pop into these things, talk about these things, and focus on the charts a little bit. Last week we saw what has to be viewed, as a bounce, an extraordinary bounce, right? We had that big high volume low, came off that low, where we had looked at last week as, an idea that we may see some resistance was here. So if you remember, we were on this bar last week when we, looked at the show. Monday pushes up, Tuesday spikes over the top. And then Wednesday actually comes back and tests into that area that it broke, which was the bearish retest regen. Once that held, up, up, and away, right? Now we're up here at the breakdown bar, the top of it. And, I believe that I had shown, the possibility that, this range trade that was developing would be something like this, or potentially, something higher. And definitely it's the higher. And now the question is, of course, will this stop it? This is the congestion area, all these price points in here. I kind of thought that we'd get a push up. My envision last week was some sort of a push up into this resistance zone, a pullback from there, and then potentially the ABCD structure, to get up here to the top of the range. If you pulled back deeper, it would actually take you right to the top of that range. Well, that's not the way it played out. Instead, we simply got a spike higher, five more days, four of the 5 days straight up. And we're sitting at the top of the range now. And that range now, if I draw it out and think about it, it's this area back to here now to start with, or potentially this area back to here. So any kind of a retest or retrace back to the backside, you have to be looking here as the first place that is probably going to find support. And if there's something that's driving this down, it's the top of the high volume low as the zone. So I would think that's, these two price points on the way back. Now, what if this thing just keeps going? What if it truly is the V-shape, reversal that, truly regenerates even higher? I mean, yeah, it's possible, but man, you got to think that's a long shot. Think about it this way. Even on the way down, you had some congestion, right? Then you had the plunge. So, to assume that you're going to go straight up without any kind of congestion, really seems like a far-fetched notion at this point. What we should be looking for, rather than just, saying, oh, this could happen or that can happen, is what we should be looking for is clues, right? That's what we always need to do, and that's what we should be doing here. And the way to do that, and it's turned out that probably one of the best reads on the top side right now is the IVB, the biotechs. This is a high beta group, and it has been one of the strongest. As a matter of fact, it turned before the others. So, here last week, or the prior week, I should say, on the 15th was the low. And if we look at the spike up, we had volume off the bottom, right? And then that spike just basically never gave it up. So the 16th, you know, was the spike off the bottom. 17th just kind of held. Then we came into this week, and then it was just a charge, you know, straight up. This sector has been certainly the strongest sector. And now, you know, it has gone bullish. And with it being bullish, now what you can think about is retest regenerates on the downside. And given that it has a high beta, you know, I wouldn't be surprised to see it come back and do that retest. The breakout was confirmed. Volume expanded over this high. You broke three highs here. And if you look at the weekly, let me get the right one up. Let me pull up the chart here. The weekly on the IBB also has broken a new highs. So you basically have multiple swing point breaks to new highs. Well, it's not quite that way, because here you didn't really have a swing point high. You didn't stay down long enough. So there wasn't six bars, and this one had already been previously taken out. But you're at higher highs. Maybe that's the way I should say it. So you got higher highs here. You know, remember, we had been testing on the monthly as well. On the monthly now, you're actually going to go over the highs if you stay up here. So, you know, this definitely has the momentum to try to take itself even higher. Given the surge, you would think you would get some sort of a pullback, a retest, and regenerate. Now, if it pulls back and it regenerates higher, that's a good clue that the risk is still on. And that's what I would be looking at, is, okay, is the strongest sectors finding support and the buyers want to step in and put money to work, right, as soon as it comes back to that area from which it broke out from. That gives you a good indication that that's what's happening. If you look at the IYT, transports, changes trend to bullish. It is suspect, but it got over this high. So here again, retest, regenerate off the high. If I look at the industrials, and remember, the Dow theory is based on these two. Industrials did the same thing, over, a retest, regenerate off this high. Now, after this surge, this retest, regen is going to be very hard. In other words, it's going to be hard not to break down below this high's low. So if I draw it in, and you can envision it here, that's the retest regen area, which basically was low on Friday. You know, can this thing hold that kind of a surge? In other words, will the retrace not be able to get back down here somewhere? If it doesn't, that's a very bullish sign, and that says that we probably are going higher. I doubt that's going to happen, but that's something we can watch to tell us, right? Because more than likely, this thing will trade down in here, and then what does that do? That says, hey, you got a range, right? The range is, you finally found the top of the range, and that range is somewhere like, you know, one of these two. And so, you know, maybe it could be higher, but certainly the range is developing. And I suspect the range is what we're going to see. So that's the sort of thing we can watch for to give us some clues as to what's next. Now, the other odd thing that I want to show you, and this is an odd market. I mean, it's not a normal market anymore, and it hasn't been for a long time. And part of that is showing up again in a different way, and it has to do with what the leading sectors are. You know, this is a chart I pulled many, many years ago. What is this? 1999 off of StockCharts.com. And I've kept it around because it's a nice indication of what's going on in bull and bear markets. And in the green line here is the bull. The red line is the bear. And what it's saying is that, you know, last week, if you remember, we talked about distribution and accumulation at the highs and the lows. Well, we're certainly not at the lows, but the real question is this really distribution? And from a market cycle point of view, you would think it might be, right? Because if you look at this and if you look at what's leading in terms of leading sectors, you know, the leading sectors right now are what? They're your consumer staples, your utilities, right? Those are the ones that are leading right now. And when those lead, you're usually right up into this area. You're at the top, you know, and potentially you're starting to roll over. And when your cyclicals, you know, start to kick in again, you know, then you're down here somewhere and you're going to be going back the other way. So, you know, I believe that with this kind of scenario, you know, historically this has meant you're kind of topping. And you need to consider that, you know, maybe this is the distribution top forming at this point. The question will be, you know, or the question in my mind is, do we have so much distortions as a result of the Federal Reserve that maybe this chart doesn't apply equally anymore like it used to? You know, in other words, you know, why would you see so much money flying into utilities when maybe it's still a bull market? Well, because there's no place else to earn money. You know, you can't get any returns in normal places. And so maybe you have to pack into these utilities and you pack into the staples because they pay big dividends. And you're using them as your dividend play, right? As your interest rate play. Because you can't put that money in anything else that's going to give you any kind of return, right? The money markets give you zero. Even short-term notes give you nothing. I mean, there's just no other place to get yield. So maybe this is the new quote-unquote yield place, and therefore it's really not a sign of a top. It's just a sign of a place to park money that is quote-unquote viewed as safer that gives you returns. So maybe this whole thing doesn't work anymore. I hate to throw something like this out, though, and say, hey, you know, it's different. You know how it is. It's different this time. Well, it always never seems to be different this time. So I you know, it's something I keep watching. I keep thinking about. It just, you know, it flies in the face of historical norms, the way the market's reacting. But then again, this whole market doesn't act like a normal market. And you and I both probably agree on that. So, you know, are we topping? You know, or can, or does this no longer tell us what it used to? I don't know the answer to that. And I don't think we have to know the answer to that. I think we just have to be aware of that and consider that and continue to, you know, read what the market's doing and try to use that going forward. So just something I want to throw out that's kind of a compliment to what we did last week with this whole idea of distribution and so forth. So what's the positives, right? Multiple sectors refuse to regenerate lower, right? Underscoring this whole range thing, you know, at worst. And I could pop through them all, and you probably are already aware what they are, but we've already pointed out the IBB, the IYT, you know, the XLF refused to stay down. The XLK is actually coming back up and it's gotten over that low as well, and so forth, right? All these guys have refused to stay down. So that pretty much tells us this is a range trade. The only question is, where's the top of the range? You know, is the top of the range going to be up here at the highs and it's going to be this huge range? Or is it something less? I suspect it's going to be less, but we haven't seen the top of the range yet. Another thing that was positive was the XLE just refused, you know, to break down any farther, in particular, you know, on the monthly time frame. And what I want to show you is this. You know, this thing came down, let's get the XLE up. This thing came down on the monthly, tested that swing point low, huge volume, right, tested into it. It was also testing back into a bullish retest regen. Right, this breakout, finally you're retesting into it again, and it held. Now, there's a lot of volume there, and that suggests that, you know, it's probably not over yet, but on a long-term basis, it did hold, and that really is a positive. That whole, you know, regeneration thing is based on the ideal that you get on each time frame. You know, if you envision this and you go across the board here, so in other words, if I go back to the daily, right here, it looks like total destruction. If I go to the weekly, right, the weekly actually comes back and tries to retest regen off the high but fails. And you can see how these sorts of things play out across multiple time frames. Okay, so if the weekly can't hold, can the monthly? Does it hold a swing point low? Does it hold a retest regen on a bullish basis? Yeah, it's got a lot of volume, but yes, it held. And that's a positive, right? That says this market, even if it is topping, it still isn't quite ready. And it's going to take time. And time is always the arbiter here. And that's what's happening. Another very positive situation was the Russell. You know, if we take a look at the Russell, you know, this has been the weakest guy on a monthly basis back inside the range, right? You got that range up here. You know, this was the breakdown out of the range. And quite frankly, I'm surprised it held, but it did. It's back inside the range. That's on a monthly basis. If you look at it on the weekly basis, remember it had broken multiple swing point lows, lots of them. Usually you're not going to go right back up, but that's what it's doing. Top of this lowest bar, you know, the top of the lowest swing point low bar, 11.1504. Where did it close? 11.19, I think it was, 11.18, almost 11.19. So you're back over it. So this, again, has failed to regenerate lower. And certainly you want to see like one more bar that holds up here to tell you that. But, you know, it's an indication of how strong this market really is in that it doesn't want to regenerate lower, at least not yet. And so that's a range trade here. It's a range trade in multiple other places. Another thing has to do with just the earnings. If we look at the FactSet earnings, 41% of the company's actual results that are reported, right? Most of them are showing EPS estimates that are above expectations and actual sales that were above expectations compared to the historical averages. So, you know, the earnings season, even though it hasn't been great, it hasn't been terrible. And that's a reflection of the economy. And a big piece of what's going to drive whether this is really a topping process or not is going to be the economics over time. And there's a lot of data coming out again the next 2 weeks, so we'll get more of a read there. But those are very positives. On the negative side, the projections going forward are not great, right? 29% of companies issued negative, only 8 increased it. And the other big one that I see in terms of just the technical side is the SOX. If I look at the SOX, the SOX is coming back up, doing a retest regen off this low, hasn't gotten over it yet. Now it's had a huge bounce as well, you know, but that is a very negative situation. Technology is what you want to see lead. It's leading with biotech. It's not leading here with the SOX. It is kind of leading with the big cap tech. In other words, Apple, not so much Google, but Apple and Microsoft. And so, and Facebook actually is becoming a big one. But this one, you want to see it get over this swing point low and make it a range trade. And so far that hasn't happened. So that would be one technical negative that's still out there. The other negative, even technically, is the world markets. You know, if you look at these world markets, they're not healthy. They're just not healthy at all. And that's true in Asia, and it's true in Europe. If I look at, if I pop up Europe, for example, and look at the FTSE, this is doing a retest regen off this low. The DAX is doing the same thing, right? So Europe is struggling, and I know that Draghi's trying to do his thing with the central bank, flushing more money in, trying to do a quasi-QE, but so far it's not doing much for the continent. FTSE can't even get back to the lows. And so, you know, Europe is not that strong. And then I was just talking about the SOX. If we go over to Asia, you know, Taiwan is struggling at the lows. I mean, this is not particularly healthy, and this is a reflection of chips. The Nikkei off of the continued devaluation of the yen, which is the only trade that they have right now, is getting a decent bounce, but it's just coming in to do a retest regen off the lows as well, the higher ones, right? It's already gotten over this, suggesting it's a range trade. But, you know, for the most part, these are not doing well. Hong Kong, you know, the 8 shares in China, to our north, the friends in Canada are just doing a bounce. If I look at the Australian market, that one's just coming back to do the retest regen. Brazil is all about the election, so it's kind of an odd one. But in general, world markets really not showing much strength. Fundamentals, it's going to be a full pack week again. You got all the earnings. You got the Fed again this week. You know, when I get to the, you know, what I think is going to happen, I think you're going to probably see some sort of sell the news off the Fed. And because we've had this huge bounce, and it's a setup that just seems to be in place now. There's a lot more data, durable goods, confidence numbers, various Fed manufacturing indexes. The FOMC is on Wednesday. And then you start getting the PMI starting next week. And then you have a huge slew of earnings again this week. This week and next are the big, you know, last week, this week, and next week are the big three. And so you're going to have a huge set of earnings. And as you move farther into earnings, they're usually not as good as the early ones. So all those things, you know, when I look at these, there's a lot of data that can move things around. And then you still got all this geopolitical stuff. Any of these could heat up. You know, you saw the Ebola that turned the market, Wednesday. These Hong Kong demonstrations haven't gone away, and just on and on, right? So there's a lot of stuff happening that could push this market up and push it down. We've already come up a long way, so the risk is really to the downside on the geopolitical and on the economic news. Last week I postulated this whole idea of a range trade, and I think that in general that was right. You know, we had that washout. We pretty much looked at that and said, okay, that's a washout, and we're probably going to get a bounce, and we got the bounce, and then we kind of assumed it would turn into some sort of a range trade. What we didn't know is that it was going to be, you know, this huge range. I guess I should just expect that anymore with this market, but it's turned into that range. Now the question is, okay, we're going to get the top of that range or not. And as I said earlier, you really want to watch these things for the clues, and that's what I'll be watching and, you know, telling you is, you know, how are these reacting and what are they telling us? I suspect we're going to get some sort of a sell the news reaction on the Fed, either in front of it, you know, like late Monday and Tuesday, or as a result of it on Wednesday. The question will be is, you know, how far does it pull back? I kind of referred to that earlier, but let me go back and pull up the chart again here. I suspect that you're going to see, you know, this area here. Get up the chart, the S&P 500. I suspect you're going to see this area here hold on the way back. And so you kind of have this big gap right here, which happens to spawn with this low. So I would think this would be kind of the first area that I would think of as the range now. And then you have the stuff over the range, you know, a top over it, and then one underneath it. So I would, if I had to bet this week, I would think you're going to trade somewhere within this range most of the week. Maybe you'll peek out the bottom side, maybe peek out the top side. But probably the bulk of the action will be in here somewhere. And so that's where I would be looking for the range to finally set up. And then, you know, assuming that happens, now you can start thinking about larger things. And what I mean by that is, you know, let's just assume it makes it all the way up here to the top of this. And then you get the pullback, and let's just assume a deep retrace back into here. Okay, so what does that do? Well, that potentially sets up a spike all the way back to the highs, right? An ABCD structure all the way to the highs. Now, if I'm bullish, you know, I'm looking at this and I'm thinking about it in that way, and it might be easier to look at it here on the weekly. So if I'm bullish, you know, I'm looking at this and I'm saying, oh, wow, look at this. You know, it goes up here, gets a pullback, and then we go back up to new highs. That's the bullish case. Now, if I'm bearish, though, I'm sitting over here looking at this. And I'm saying, oh, wow, look at this. They get a nice big bounce, and they're going to go right back down, and they're going to break these lows finally. Now, that's a very bearish case. And, you know, is that a realistic case? Well, we won't know that until we see how this range builds out. But what I expect is you're not going to get these straight line moves. You're going to get something much more jagged, even if it's going to be this. And I suspect that's also going to be true even on the upside, right? So even if we're going to go up, I suspect this pullback is going to be a lot more jagged than just straight up, and then eventually you get the next move up. So I would think that probably what we're going to see, and going back to the daily chart here, what we're going to see is we're going to see this thing build out some sort of a range in between here. And so a lot of trading may be in this area. You know, so a lot of gyrations in here, testing the bottoms, testing the tops. But maybe over the next week, 2 weeks, you know, this sort of action, trading, maybe even 3 weeks, right, trading in here somewhere. And then eventually, if that happens, eventually that's going to set up one of two things. It's going to set up that fabled failure on the bounce. And that's the one that can hurt you. In other words, if I go back to the weekly and you look at this, right, you've had this huge run higher, you know, so just spike, 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 right, never gives it up. Every time it pulls back, it V-shapes back up, pull back, V-shape up, right? And it's done that over and over and over, and everybody's expecting that probably at this point, especially given this big bounce again. So now everybody's thinking, okay, bounce, V-shape higher to new highs. That's the most bullish scenario, and that's what we just talked about. But what if this congestion, you know, these highs, what if we can't get over them? You know, what does that do? Well, that kind of sets up, you know, looking at classical TA, that sets up some sort of a large head and shoulders type top. And if you look at the volume characteristics, they actually, they're not ideal, but they're pretty close, right? And so in other words, you know, if I were going to draw this on a classical way, I'd probably come back and say, you know, this whole area over here was the left shoulder, right? This was your top. And then, you know, something over here is going to build out to be the right shoulder. And then this really is going to be your neckline down here. And that would be, you know, characteristically, you have more volume here, less volume at the tops, right? And then much more volume as it breaks back down. And then that bounce itself, once it escalates down and breaks, if it does, you should see huge volume over here. That would be the classical TA, you know, major top. And it could play out that way. It's just we're very young into that play out, you know, when we look at it. And it's going to take a few weeks for this thing to gyrate up here to tell us which it's going to be. And then the key will be, you know, assuming it, you get this range build out, the key will be is, does it break topside or downside? If it breaks downside, you got to look out. Right? That's where you could get the major heartburn. And if it goes up topside again, it's the same thing, right? We're just back in the same old bull market that just continues. But that's going to take a while to play out. That's down the road somewhere. But that is what we have to keep thinking about, because that's where the next larger multi-month move is probably going to come from. And we want to be on the right side of that trade when it happens. Looking at the portfolio, you know, we put on the RWM thinking we had a range potentially and we could try to make a little money on the downside and then pick up some stuff for the upside. Well, so far it hasn't worked. I am lowering the stop just slightly to see if we can keep this in play until we get that pullback inside this range that I'm expecting. So you'll see that in the portfolio. AWK still looking great. You know, this company, you know, it's, let me grab the portfolio. It has continued, you know, again, this is in the utility sector. And the utility sector has continued to be strong, right? And this particular utility is a very strong one inside that sector. They report earnings in another couple of weeks. They're at new highs. They're trying to, you know, stretch on up. I think they have an ABCD structure that gets them up to another, you know, like 55, I think is the number. So strong earnings coming out, really nothing to do but just hold on to it. I don't see any reason to do anything else. ZLTQ, another one of those higher beta stocks, probably the high, well, certainly the highest beta stock we have in the portfolio. But we've got, speaking of the portfolio and where I'm going with it too, I'm thinking we're in a range trade, and I'm thinking we have to buy the next pullback. We have some high beta already in that we have Facebook, we have this one, ZLTQ, and we have Google. And those are fairly high beta ones. What I'm trying to do is move us into stuff that not move us, but add stuff that is lower beta, like the UnitedHealthcare one. And another one you're going to see this week, Nike. These aren't as high beta. They're longer term great stocks. And they kind of even out, give us some more exposure without putting a lot more beta onto the portfolio. So I just thought I should mention that just so you understand where we're trying to go with why the picks are what they are. But anyway, this one has earnings coming up next week, Tuesday, I believe. And, I've got an order to take some out here at this swing point high. I do think it's actually going to go higher again. But I don't want to have all the money on the table. So if we can pull this back, have just instead of having the, what is it, 4% I think we have now, we have 4.5. Let's just have 3% of the portfolio in it when it reports. And so that's the ideal here. If we look at the other one that's reporting next week, which is Facebook. Facebook expectations are huge. So it's already at new highs. Again, huge run off the bottom after the drift down. We already took some profit off of this on this spike back up. Let's just let it play out. And if we get, both here, ZLTQ, even in AWK, if they pull back on earnings and that pullback comes back into a nice area and the volumes don't spike too much, it'd be the place for us to finally add them again. So that's, the ideal here is let's add on weakness in strong stocks. And the other one is Google. And let's talk about Google for just a second, and then I'll wrap it up. Google had pulled back a lot, got bad earnings, spiked down, leaves volume at the bottom. The retest regen on Google is back up into this area, right? And if I look at Google on a weekly, it's also into this area, this 560 area right in here. That's the swing point high here. That's where the breakdown was. That's where we should try to take some money, about 560. So you'll see me put a couple of orders in here to try to sell into this area. And then we're going to try to buy back down here or even down into this area. And so I'm certainly not abandoning Google, but we need to trade around this position now that we've seen the earnings and seen what they've done, because this is probably going to sell down again. So we want to try to take some profits up here while we have a chance. And we need to do that Monday or Tuesday. Okay? All right, so that's it. That's it in a nutshell. This is an interesting case. I don't know what to think about it other than, is it really not applicable anymore in this world of Fed manipulations and the new QE world that we live in. It's a strange world, folks, and it's hard to stay bullish in this environment. But until we know that this really is distribution at the top and that we are probably going to break down, we have to maintain our trend, following, and that's bullish, and there's just no other way around it. We'll get some good clues off the sectors probably this week, and then that will give us a better clue as to, what's next. So let's just watch that. Let's stay long. Let's try to buy some pullbacks when they come finally and take it from there. Thanks as always for joining me. Oh, I wanted to tell you one other thing. I'd gotten a couple questions for members because, I went to the platform here where I record differently. I put this on the YouTube, but it's a hidden link, so nobody else can see it but someone who I give, not permission to, but give the link to, which is, of course, all of you. the question was, is, you know, can I share this with somebody? Well, yeah, but just be, you know, just be judicious about it. I mean, don't share every one of them. But you know, if you think that there's some folks out there that would be interested in what we do and what I do, that you know, I'm certainly not going to tell you don't share it. Share it. I mean, that's great, but be judicious. You know, and you know, don't abuse it. It's there. It's there for you, of course. And if you think that there's folks that could benefit from what I do, and you want to share it, I'm certainly not going to tell you not to. I mean, that's how this happens, and that's true of this and true of anything that you see from me. Just, you know, be judicious about how you share, and don't abuse it. And with that, I guess I'll close. Thank you as always, and I'll see you as the week gets started again here. That's it. Thanks. Takes care.